Welcome, my name is Barbara Menner, and I'm the Rothman Chair and Director of the Center for the Humanities in the Public Sphere at the University of Florida in Gainesville. Welcome to our first public lecture of the Center for the Humanities and the Public Sphere's 2020 to 2021 annual speaker series on the topic of data and democracy. This is the second installment of our multi-year speaker series that we entitled Rethinking the Public Sphere. Following last year's series, which was entitled Race and the Promise of Participation, this year's series emerged from our internal discussions in the center about how data, algorithms, and machine intelligence shape and transform the public sphere, knowledge production, and modes of communication, how algorithms reproduce existing inequalities, and finally, how the humanities can contribute to these debates and concerns. If you have not signed up for our weekly e-newsletter, we invite you to do so. We'll be posting the link to sign up in the chat at the bottom of your screen. I would like to acknowledge the funders and co-sponsors of this series, the Center for the Humanities in the Public Sphere, the Rothman Endowment, the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, the Chief Diversity Office, the Informatics Institute, the Bob Graham Center for Public Service, the Center for Latin American Studies, the African American Studies Program, the Center for Gender, Sexualities, and Women's Studies Research. I would also like to thank my colleagues, Alexandra Sinedos, Sophia Akard, and Kristen Galvin, in the Center for the Humanities in the Public Sphere for inspiring conversations about data and democracy, as well as technical, logistical, and administrative support. After I finish my introduction, Dr. Chandler will give a presentation accompanying a PowerPoint. Please put your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. I will keep track of them so you can put the questions while she's still talking, and I will repeat them to Dr. Chandler after she has completed her talk. You may also communicate with us through the chat function. We will end at 5:15 p.m. sharp at the latest, and we will record this lecture and post it on our YouTube channel at a later point. I do want to point out the other three talks that we have coming up in the series. So in January 26th at 4 p.m., it's Katherine D'Ignazio from MIT who will talk about data feminism. On February 25th at 4 p.m., it will be Rua Benjamin from Princeton talk about race to the future. And finally, April 23rd at 2 p.m., as part of our Mellon-funded Synergy Symposium, we'll host Sylvester Johnson from Virginia Tech, who will talk about will robots feel pain. You might sign up for the Zoom webinars of Katherine D'Ignazio and Rua Benjamin, and we have currently planned the symposium as a live event, but that might also change next semester. It is now my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Katherine Chandler, who's an assistant professor of culture and politics in the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University. Her book, Unmanning, How Humans, Machines, and Media Perform Drone Warfare, came out with Rutgers University Press in 2020, and it analyzes failed projects to build drone aircraft from 1936 to 1992. She's currently working on a second project on non-military uses of drones, which she discussed with a group of faculty and doctoral students last Friday in a workshop in a lively discussion about military history, surveillance, and international relations. I'm happy to welcome Dr. Chandler to UF and have her share her presentation with us now. Thank you.
Thanks so much for the wonderful introduction, and thanks so much to everyone for hosting me. I'm just going to share my screen now. So I'm really grateful to all the work that has been done by the center in order to organize this virtual visit, which has a number of logistical elements. It's been really, really great to work with the center here, and I'm very grateful to everyone for their support. So I'm going to sort of begin by talking through this problem of drone publics because it relates so clearly to the Center for the Humanities in the Public Sphere. And I also hope that in my talk, I make the case for using humanistic approaches to study technologies. I started investigating drone aircraft over 10 years ago. The emerging regime of targeted killing, to me, illustrated how media and technology were tied to and transformed by violence. Like many scholars, I initially saw the drone as a loop of targeting and military occupation from the air, newly shaped by the war on terror. And I've provided you here with a visual image that I think is an icon for how much of drone warfare continues to be discussed today. We imagine the drone as an actor targeting regions of the Middle East and North Africa as part of the ongoing war on terror. In my research, however, I came to really think about the drone and what it was doing in a different way. The title of my book, Unmanning, How Humans, Machines, and Media Perform Drone Warfare, aims to take apart the different parts of the drone to show how it networks together a constellation of humans, machines, and media to perform the version of war and to enact ongoing targeted killing. I have this slide, which I have called the technocratic regime of slow death, in order to think about the drone not as simply a drone, but as a system that brings together global infrastructures, government and bureaucratic initiatives, operators, analysts, a control interface, a whole entire military network, legal and juridical protections afforded by the US government, industrial initiatives that continue to reform and shape and transform the technology, as well as a nation state that is ostensibly protected by the drone aircraft. So I want to really emphasize that when we talk about the drone, I'm talking actually not about the drone, I'm talking about a network that connects all of these changing parts, and that is the regime of technocratic slow death that I'm describing here. The idea of drone publics draws on this particular image, which I have here as the collective to be protected. So while most scholars writing about drone warfare, and including some of my early works, emphasize the question of targeted killing and the view that the drone provided of regions in the Middle East particularly, I wanted to reverse that gaze and think about the idea of the nation that the drone is ostensibly protecting. In a recent article called Making Terrorist Targets, I was thinking about the ways in which the authorization for the use of military force is actualized through the drone aircraft, carrying out its task of killing in the name of protecting the American public. So I have this image here to think not about the drone as this sort of cycle of targeting, but rather a regime that protects certain parts of the population and attacks other parts of the population. And this is referring to a global population and the sort of networks of connectivity that make that possible, but then are divided in terms of who is enabled to live and who is killed. To further think about this thesis of protection and how protection relates to technological systems, I was interested in this exercise of parsing out what I'm calling drone publics by briefly analogizing it to the public that we're currently experiencing on Zoom. And I want to highlight to all of you how this is a totally imperfect analogy. And again, I'm here using the humanistic term analogy to point out to you what maybe a humanities scholar brings to the discussion of drone warfare by thinking about the question of drones and the ideas of the technocracy and public life and bringing it to the present moment of drone a present moment of organizing public life on Zoom. So obviously there's very different protections that are afforded through Zoom and protections that are being afforded by drone aircraft. But similarly, there are populations that are being exposed and let to die, and there's populations that are being protected by these technological systems. And it's that division that I want to highlight and think about in terms of the problems it exposes for the public sphere and how the challenge of rethinking the public sphere in the age of data and democracy needs to address these fundamental imbalances. So I've just provided you here with a brief visual image to illustrate for you, again, the sort of imperfect analogy between experiencing life on Zoom and the image of drone warfare. So I want to think about this particular image as showing us the ways in which real-time image connectivity through audio and visual information plays out in the ideas of protection and the ideas of making a public. And to briefly make my point, I want to spend a moment thinking first about the public and then thinking about the ways in which the Zoom calls and drone aircraft can be made analogous. So first, I just want to share with you the idea of a Zoom public before we go back to the question of what is a drone public and how they might be related. And I found this widely shared image of the first parliamentarian meeting on Zoom, which was held this past August by Boris Johnson's government. And again, I think one of the things that's really important is that during the pandemic, Zoom has become a stand-in for what the public sphere is supposed to be. So institutions associated with the functions of government, education, and arts, as well as the normalization for some of work from home, have made this particular platform something that is supposed to be a replacement for a public space. And I want to think about the ways in which it does that and does not do that. And I also want to think about how Zoom transforms how we think about public space, given the ways in which it also may teach us how the drone transforms questions of what is happening in public space. So we might think about how this scene organizes real-time image and sound transmissions from multiple transmissions from distinct locations, making it possible to be seen and heard by anyone, anywhere, at least for those participants in the Zoom call. And I also want you to think about the ways in which the Zoom platform flattens the normal hierarchical relations that would be organizing something like Parliament, although of course they continue to exist, and the ways in which this image blurs the boundaries between personal or private space and the public life, giving us glimpses into people's homes, outside of people's windows, as well as, you know, onto people's iPhones, into the boardrooms of the cabinet room and to the press team. How is this a very different image than the one we typically think about in terms of what the public sphere is? So I want to briefly turn to this question of how I think both the drone and Zoom afford protections before I get to this other problem of the ways in which they are an expression of structural inequalities and the problems associated with imagining the public sphere as a place where we all have equal access, particularly imagining technologies as necessarily providing equal access. So again, this is an imperfect analogy, and I'm not saying these systems are at all the same, but I do think it's worth thinking about the ways in which one of the real transformations brought about by drone warfare is the ways it changes the international space of war and the domestic space of the nation, blurring the boundaries between the two. And as I already suggested, Zoom does something similar, blurring the boundaries between my home into the sort of public space of the university lecture, which would have been something we wouldn't have thought of 5 to 10 years ago. And how on-screen access for certain people makes it possible to interact in a battlefield, to go to work or school through an internet connection or through real-time video and audio transmission, which occur in the case of drone aircraft through a satellite link, right? And the ways in which these technologies touch high to changing limits. Limits in the case of the drone between nation states, between the means for war and the means for peacekeeping. The way in which Zoom is utterly transforming limits between work and home. And how this way is networking multiple relations across multiple people across multiple spaces and times. Of course, I think the two systems also share some similar pitfalls. So I'm going to briefly share a few cartoons to sort of think about the ways in which this idea of being able to see anything, anywhere, of course, obscures the ways in which the camera is always pointed in a very particular direction and can also hide all the things that are left off screen. Perhaps the screen is actually a very poor frame in terms of thinking about what these technologies are doing. And similarly here, the predator system was known as being able to see through a straw. And while I've been assured by military personnel that the newer systems no longer have the visual limits that the predator did, you can see that this is a very tiny camera and a very tiny perspective of how the system is actually operating. And I want to just point out a few more technological breakdowns that again disrupt the sort of connectivity and the relationality that seems to be provided by technologies like drones or technologies like Zoom, and think about how the connection breaks down, how they can be hacked, and importantly, how we become fatigued and exhausted by being on screen all the time. Up to this point, I have been talking about a we as if there is an entire public that is able to participate in either the optics of being a drone pilot or the optics of participating in Zoom. Of course, this is absolutely not the case. And instead, the sort of privilege of being protected by the drone public or the privilege of being protected by Zoom and being afforded the possibility of work from home obscures the much broader conditions of structural violence and persons who do not have access to these platforms and are thus in completely different circumstances and conditions. So I briefly want to go through some of the most recent statistics on the ongoing effects of drone warfare, which in the name of protecting the United States has carried out since 2001 over 14,040 confirmed strikes and has killed somewhere between 8,858 and 16,901 persons. This is according to the Bureau for Investigative Journalism. And these are, of course, part of the war on terror, which is the longest declared war in U.S. history. And of course, drones have not been prominent part of the most recent administration or the past 4 years. There's been a lot of discussion of other structural violences enacted by the Trump administration, but there have been 10 times more strikes through drone aircraft in Afghanistan, Somalia, and Yemen during the past 4 years under Trump. And these are, of course, it's not just drone strikes that are happening. These are part of a broader war with ongoing damage to social and material infrastructure. So again, on the backdrop of protection for some, we have, on the other hand, violence for others. And similarly, I want to sort of highlight how the protections afforded by Zoom, which of course should be should be open and really provide me and everyone else who has the possibility to work from home with the opportunity to protect themselves and protect others against ongoing transmission. But of course, much of the American population is not afforded the opportunity of working from home, even as we've lost 3.8 million jobs. And these have led to massive structural differences in terms of who is hospitalized for COVID-19, tying not just to access to technologies, but of course, access to healthcare, access to education, access to government, access to politics. So as I put stars on both of these, I'm not arguing at all that Zoom or drone warfare are causing these. These are caused by institutional decisions that are made by lots of actors. It's those actors that I want to hold accountable, the humans, not the humans who are advocating that we use drones or that we operate on Zoom indefinitely. That is what I want us to think about and to question, using the technologies to illustrate the sort of technological divides and the inequalities that these systems are symptoms of. And I really do, in my work on drone aircraft and in this initial speculation on Zoom, I think the abolition of drone technology, it needs to rather be a questioning of the humans and the actors and the politics that is organizing the use of drone warfare. And I do believe that the systems could be organized or understood in different ways. So let me try to come back again to this question of what is the public? And how these technologies ask us to think about the public in a different kind of way, and also are revealing of some of the ongoing discussions and debates that happen around the public. And I wanted to briefly bring in the work of Hannah Arendt and a quote that has long left me thinking, both about drone aircraft and more recently about Zoom. So I'm going to read it for you, the second part of the quote. This is after the part that's in italics, which are in the original. But she says that the contemporary non-public, the ways in which we no longer have a public sphere, and this is in The Human Condition and written in 1958, she says, the weirdness of the situation resembles a spiritualistic seance, which a number of people gathered around a table might suddenly, through some magic trick, see the table vanish from their midst, so that two persons sitting opposite each other were no longer separated, but also would be entirely unrelated to each other by anything tangible. And so some of the problems and some of the ways in which the drone and Zoom seem to organize a public also seem to be brought out in this idea of this magic trick where we are all instantly connected to each other. And I think we can all see how this might describe a Zoom call, where it is as if we were gathered around a table and two people sitting opposite each other are sort of made immediately connected. But we are no longer related by anything tangible. And I think this question of how can we think about relationality and accountability and responsibility through platforms like Zoom, which sort of make us immediately connected but totally distant. And I think there's something similar that's happening in the way in which drone warfare proposes a sort of immediate connectivity to the battlefield, even as it happens from enormous distances. What would it mean to make that tangible? And how can there be a common world made in these digital platforms that seem to highlight a sort of flattening of the world? And I think part of what needs to be done in order to make this possible is to think sort of outside of the screen and think about how the systems are built and maintained and the processes and ideas that become embedded in their making and imagine the possibility and the conditions for their remaking. So in the final part of my talk, I want to briefly go through a couple portions of my research to describe to you how I have examined how the drone was made in order to reveal some of the assumptions about the system, and then some current research that I'm working on where I consider if the drone can be put back together to propose a democratizing relationship rather than a divisive one. So as I mentioned earlier, one of the striking things about my research, or as Barbara also mentioned in the introduction, was that I thought that I was going to work about contemporary drone warfare until I realized how hard it was going to be to get any form of access to contemporary drone warfare. So instead, I sought out how I could understand what was happening through the lens of drone warfare through archival information. And luckily, I found a vast archive of materials, particularly 120 boxes of documents from the interwar and World War II that describe the Navy project, which was known by the code name drone, which has since become the common parlance for an unmanned aircraft system. So at that time, it was a pilotless plane, and the project to build the pilotless plane was known by the code name drone, though by 1946, the drone was sort of the common term that we used to talk about unmanned aircraft. And I'm sharing with you in this particular image a headline from a New York Times Sunday magazine from 1946, "The Drone Portent of a Push-Button War." And I'm just bringing this out because one of the things I realized in my research was that this idea of automatic war and automation as sort of driving forward targeted killing has a long prehistory, long before the rise of the war on terror. And so this was an idea that had been tested in World War II. And I'm going to briefly take you through this project. And I'm getting to talk about the cancellation at the end, but in the rest of my book, I explore how the project continues to reemerge in the 1960s, 1970s, and 1980s. And I'm interested in the ways in which all of these failed projects suggest a different way of thinking about contemporary drone warfare, and also what the contemporary drone is or what it does. So I'm going to start with a memo from 1934 from Vladimir Zworykin, who many of you may know is often called the father of television. All, of course, that title is, there's others who are suggested as being the inventors of television, but RCA promoted Zworykin as the father of television. And in the 1920s, 1930s, and 1940s, the idea of what television was going to be did not yet have a solid foundation. And Zworykin saw television as actually being very useful to military technologies. In 1934, sent a proposal to the US Navy called a flying torpedo with an electric eye. And in it, he basically suggested that the new television camera that he had invented could be a targeting technology for remote controlled torpedoes. And in this memo from 1934, he indicates that one possible means of obtaining practically the same results as the suicide pilot is to provide a radio controlled torpedo with an electric eye. And so in this work in 1934, he analogizes the drone with the act of suicide bombing. Although of course quickly goes on to say it's the humanitarian aspect of the drone, namely that there would not be a pilot on board, that makes this a humane option because it would only attack the enemy and protect the American soldier. So at this point, the idea of suicide bombing was something that had been done by some pilots of various different nationalities in various aerial battles that had occurred prior to World War II. And of course, air battles were not carried out at scale really until World War II. So the idea also of what air warfare was still also being determined. But this was taken up by the And this is a rendering of what they imagined this aerial warfare looking like. And again, how the television is used to control the aircraft, which is seen as a platform for bombs used to attack the ships below. And these are early images associated with a test of the aircraft. And so you can see again how this appears to be the drone being used to attack a freighter ship in Guadalcanal. What is not apparent in these particular images is that this is only a test. So it is not actual ship that is armed. It's rather a ship that had been defeated in a previous battle that is used to carry out this particular enactment of television guided bombing, which was then made into a film that was used to promote the project and to get permission for it to be tested for 46 missions in September to October 1944. But because the test occurred in 1944, this was also when numerous Japanese kamikaze missions were killing many U.S. Navy sailors, and also attacking ships in the Pacific. And the Navy group that ran the drone mission with the television guided targets analogized their particular system as the American kamikaze. And this was published self-published as a book in 1984, and I analyze it in some detail in my project, in my research. I just want to pull out one of the quotes though and see how the idea of targeting by television both confuses and disavows, both indicates the connections of what can be seen on screen and disavows the sort of relationality between the operator and the target. And so in the remembrances of this particular project, one of the operators says, "Yeah, I got shot down once or twice. Anti-aircraft fire just brought it down." And this is referring not to his plane, it's referring to the drone. But the drone becomes the operator, suggesting this form of connectivity and the sort of way in which through the drone, the operator was able to imagine himself as a machine. But then in the next sentence, he displaces or undoes this form of relationality. "I didn't have control, but the picture was still on the screen, and all of a sudden I was looking straight down and couldn't do anything about it. If it had been a piloted plane, I'd have been shot down. It would have been a funeral." And so in the final part, through the sort of crash of the aircraft and its detonation of whatever explosives it have, its use against the enemy and the possible deaths it might cause becomes understood instead as the possible funeral of the operator. And again, the idea of the drone here is not just tied to the question of attack, but tied to this question of protection and the way in which the operator is able to, through the screen, ultimately displace and escape the death that is part of what would be seen on screen. This project was not actually a success. It was canceled by the military, and it was largely seen as a fiasco in the aftermath of World War II, in part because of infighting among Navy personnel and within the Navy hierarchy over the direction of the Navy, as well as because the technologies and the technologies, particularly the aircraft, were made out of plywood and very difficult to actually maneuver or to fly. And Vannevar Bush, who many of you may know, was sort of considered the czar of scientific research during the war and helped direct the course of science in the aftermath, described the drone project as an actual fiasco. And so it's the reconstruction of the history in the 1980s with the rise of new guided missile systems, as well as the sort of precursors of contemporary drone warfare that sparked renewed interest in this project and sort of brought it back to light. But the aftermath of this drone project did not stop in 1947, and in fact lived on in the image orthicon, which was what was developed by RCA to make the planes that I described to you and showed briefly in the previous slides. So we have here the image orthicon, which would have been used in all RCA television sets produced up until 1968. And the orthicon was such an important part of the television that it was called the Emmy, and the Emmy Awards are named after it. So we can see a direct link to these drones from the World War II, not in the development of military drones, but in the development of commercial television and the ways in which these technologies ended up in all of our television sets. And it's with that in mind that I want to think about how the ideas of connectivity and relationality that are often proposed as sort of the foundations of media, we can think about this in Marshall McLuhan's Extensions of Man as thinking about the television set, all the way through some of the early thinking about the internet in the 90s, and still today as sort of a medium for connectivity. It's complicated by the divides and the real separations that are imagined by choosing, by defining who is an enemy and who is a friend through the sort of lens of a camera that comes out so clearly in the American Kamikaze Project. And I think this brings us back in some ways to the Arendtian public and the problems that many, not just myself, have noted with her ideal of the public, as there's no place for violence and there's no way of thinking about the ways in which inequalities and violences continue to persist in the public sphere. So it's with this in mind that my most recent research has turned to drone aircraft being used on the African continent. And this is a project that is defined as, you know, using the drone as a democratizing technology because of its low cost and its possible uses for mapping and other forms of aerial photography that are typically not accessible unless you have an airplane or access to a satellite. I spent some time on this project talking to the participants where they use this small drone to ultimately map the entire island of Zanzibar. The project took a long time, so it took 2 to 3 years to map it with this very small drone. When I went out with them, we would fly about 2 to 3 flights a day, and it slowly, piecemeal, put together a map of Zanzibar. And much of the time was actually spent not collecting the images on the drone, but trying to process them on the computer. And it was more the mosaicing of the images and the software associated with that that was harder to access than the actual question of the drone. So I want to share the pictures of this because, again, it gives us such a different image of what we think about when we think about drone aircraft, and again highlight what happens when we look at how drone flight is made and enacted and how you get a very different sense of what the drone is than simply a set of images on screen. This was a really very popular entertainment. The kids in town loved coming to watch the drone flights happen, and everything took place from the back of a pickup truck. I took pictures of the batteries because the batteries had a real hard time keeping a charge. I mean, I'd say about 1 in 3 of the drone flights would actually have to be stopped in order to fix a battery or deal with the various different battery problems. So I'm out of time. This is a brief video where I show myself to be a drone participant. And again, after sort of illustrating for you all of the problems and the ways in which I see the drone as a reflection of global structural violences, I also found lots of fun in flying drones and really enjoyed my participation in this project. But I want to then come back to the question of what is happening, what kind of public is being made, what kind of information is being accessed, and what does that mean for this question of what is democracy? So again, the idea was to create a map that would be open access to many different people and would be available for people to download. But there were other interests that were funding the project, which included the local government, as well as the local oil, Statoil, which had the drilling rigs offshore. And of course, the project was of enormous interest to them as well, because the map would provide more detailed information about the resources and the land that was on Zanzibar. So again, the question of who is the public that is being imagined for this project and who is going to be the person that is downloading or accessing these information that, ideally could be made available to a much broader public through the use of drone aircraft. So I'm going to end with those sets of questions, and I look forward to providing additional details and responding to your comments in the question and answer session.